Hello and welcome back to the channel. So this lecture, we are going to discuss our another NoSQL database, which is MongoDB. So in the previous lecture, we have worked with Cassandra and integrated it with Spark to populate the data from a data file stored in SDFS. But now we'll start our journey and learn what is MongoDB and some basic features. So without further ado, let's get into it. So you may ask, what really is a MongoDB? So MongoDB is a document-oriented database. So it's a NoSQL database, which means it comes with a flexible schema and used for handling big data. And this MongoDB database is specifically made for storing document-oriented files. So what are those? Let's discuss in the next topic. But unlike tabular format, which we've seen in the relational databases such as MySQL, this MongoDB uses the collections and documents here. So this collections contains a set of documents and function which is equivalent to the relational database tables. So MongoDB serves big enterprises and also supports their architecture. So if you're up for a big company who generates a huge amount of data, it may be worth to learn about MongoDB. So now let's discuss what really is a document and how the data is stored in it. So this is one example of a document, and here you can see it could be a flexible schema. So it is not like you should have the data having the fixed order or a schema. So here you can see the data has been stored in a key value pair. So here the key would be first name and this is the value for it. Then we have the surname, cell, city, and we have used different data types to store these values. So here you can see the first one is string. As you can see, for cell number, it's number. And for location, it is like a geo coordinates. And then we can have an array. So the values can contain an array and also this field. So here, as you can see, this cars field can contain an array of sub-documents, and it is a flexible schema. So it is not like every document should have this specific number of fields or a sub-documents present in it. So that makes it suitable where you're dealing with sparse data, which is not that much tied together like in relational databases. So now let's discuss where are we on the CAP theorem triangle. So this MongoDB lies on the consistent and partition tolerance side. So you already know that partition tolerance is the need of big data, and we should definitely have that. So when we talk about Cassandra in the previous lectures, that was made up for higher availability, which can serve the front-end applications. But if we talk about MongoDB, it is having a consistency rather than having the higher availability. So it may be not available because it has the master slave architecture, or you can say it has the master node which has control of all the processes. And if the primary master node goes down, then our application would not be available and having a downtime until you replace it back. So that is the trade-off of using the MongoDB. But it will give you a consistent result. But it is not similar to MySQL or any other relational database. You cannot give joins or any other operations. So the data should be in the denormalized state. It will have a large tables. So in this case, we will call it as collection. And you can have access to those quickly. But it is not like SQL, and you cannot do the join operations on top of it. So this makes it very suitable solution for handling huge amounts of data, or you can say big data. So the primary purposes of building this MongoDB was nothing but it should have a higher scalability. So it should scale up or down as per the user requirement. It should have a high performance as well as the availability, but it favors consistency over availability, as we have seen in this CAP theorem. And also it should have a flexible schema to serve huge amount of sparse data. So it is not mandatory that your all documents should have same key pairs, and you can pretty much have any data stored as a key value pair, which will have either a blob storage or JSON document. You can put it in MongoDB. So now let's talk about some of the main features of MongoDB. So the first one is it supports the ad hoc queries. So which means we can search by any field, or else we can run a range query. And it also supports regular expression searches. So it pretty much comes handy when you're dealing with huge amounts of data, and all in the denormalized form. Then we can have the indexing. So we can index any field in a document. So indexing will comes in the picture during the optimization. So as we have seen in the relational databases, we can create an index. So if we are using some of the fields more often in our select query or during the retrieval of the data, then it makes sense to create an index for that particular column, which gives us the higher performance during retrieval of that data. So in that case, indexing will be a good option to optimize your query performance. The next one is, it is a schema-less database, which means it is not mandatory to have the same structure to every document. You can put any document having the key value pairs in MongoDB, which is different than a relational databases which has the same schema to a particular table. Then we have the replication. So replication comes in picture where we're dealing with big data which is spread across the commodity hardware. So this supports master-slave replication. So which means master can perform read and writes and the slaves can copy the data from the master and can only be used for reads or the backup purposes, but not during the write operations. And it integrates with MapReduce and different aggregation tools. So we can use MongoDB as a standalone system, or else we can integrate with MapReduce as well as Spark to work with the big data. So how to integrate those services, we are going to see in the upcoming lectures where we will work with MongoDB and play with some data on it. And also I like to mention some of the key features such as load balancing. So MongoDB has an automatic load balancing configuration because the data is played in shards. Now let's talk about some of the key components of MongoDB architecture. So the first one is ID. So this field required in every MongoDB document. So this field represents a unique value in our document and is like the primary key of that particular document. So if you create a new document without ID field, without this ID field, MongoDB will automatically create it for you. Now we have the collections. So this is a grouping of MongoDB documents. So collection means it's a collection of different documents and is equivalent of a table which is created in our conventional RDBMS such as Oracle or MySQL. So collection exists within a single database. The next one is a cursor. So cursor is nothing but a pointer to the result set of a query. So end users can iterate through this cursor for retrieving the desired output. And next we have the database. So I hope you already know that it is a container for collections like tables, which we saw in RDBMS. So database store all sorts of tables as well as views and all other relational entities. And each database gets its own set of files on the file system. And MongoDB can have numerous amounts of databases. Then we have the document. So document is nothing but a record in a MongoDB collection. So if we compare it to the RDBMS, database is similar in both the RDBMS and MongoDB, and the table is similar to the collection, and the tuples or rows are compared to the document. So documents are nothing but the rows in the relational databases, and the collection is nothing but a table but not in the tabular format. It's just like a collection of different documents and which may have a flexible schema assigned to it. And the last one is field. So this field is nothing but a name value pair in a document. As we have seen in the earlier topic where we discuss how the document look like, it is just like a key for our document. So these fields are similar to the columns in relational databases. So if we just compare it to the actual document here, the first name would be the field and pol is nothing but the value of that field having a specific data type to it. And the surname, cell, city is nothing but fields. And it has the different values. And you can query this document on the basis of the different fields, which we will be discussing in the upcoming lectures. So there are some considerations you have to make to build your MongoDB architecture. So it may include the needs of the application, where we need to focus on the business needs of the particular application, and we need to analyze what type of data needed for that application. And based on this, we have to ensure the structure of that document which is decided accordingly. Then we also have to consider the data retrieval patterns. So if you have a heavy query usage, then we have to consider for creating indexes to improve the efficiency and reduce the query execution time. Then we also have to consider the frequent inserts as well as updates and removals which happen over time in the database. So we have to consider sharding strategy for data modeling and designing to improve the efficiency of our MongoDB architecture. So at last, let's talk about some of the advantages of MongoDB. So the first advantage is it is a schemaless database. So schemaless means this database is based on the document-oriented database in which the one collection can hold different sorts of documents and it doesn't have any specific schema assigned to it. And the number of fields as well as content and size of the document can differ from one to another. And if you talk about joins, as it should have the denormalized schema, you cannot execute complex join operation on our collection of data. So in NoSQL, generally, as we seen in Cassandra, the schema is denormalized one, which doesn't have. So unlike the different joins which you use in RDBMS to join two or more tables on base of some key, there is nothing here. You can query it pretty much on the basis of its fields, as well as we can do all sorts of regular expression, but complex joins are not possible on MongoDB and it is not recommended as well. Then the next advantage is deep query ability. So which means it supports dynamic queries on the documents which we inserted using document-based query language. And it's nearly as powerful as SQL. So you can pretty much get all the required results in a matter of seconds. And you can run that query very efficiently over the huge volume of data files. So which makes it a highly performant system. Then it is highly scalable. So it can scale in and out as per the requirement very easily, which is the need of every growing organization. And it also has faster access to data. So it uses internal memory for storing the working sets. It will enable some faster access to the data. So these are some reasons many of the organizations are already using MongoDB to store this huge amount of non-relational data. So to sum it up, MongoDB is a NoSQL database which stores the documents which can be in JSON or blob format, and it has a flexible schema so you can store the sparse data, and it also is suitable for agile development purposes. And due to its high consistency as well as the partition tolerance, it is suitable for big data application. So if your organization generates a huge amount of data, you should definitely consider MongoDB as a storage layer to your application. So in the next lecture, we will set up and install MongoDB on our SDB sandbox and we'll play with some data, and also we'll integrate it with Spark to read and write the data effectively. So if you like this lecture, please hit subscribe and also ring the notification bell to get the latest updates. And don't forget to follow us on our social media, which I have linked in the description below. Thanks for watching.